This is the Sports Timeout Podcast with Brooklyn Farrell, Tony Caronco, and your host, Wes Underwood. Give the people something
different. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce my album. Hope. What's my definition of success? Listening to what your heart says. Standing up at what you know is. Well, everybody else is. Talking until we turn back legs. What's my definition of success? Creating something no one else can. Something that we're talking never happened. It's a person that can see the bright side through the dark times when there ain't one. It's like someone who ain't never had nothing and afraid to walk away from. More perfect cause they'd rather do something that they really love and take the pay cut. It's a person that would never waver or change who they are just to try and gain some credibility so they can feel accepted by a stranger. It's a person that can take the failures in their life and turn them into motivation. It's believing in yourself when no one else does. It's amazing what a little bit of faith can't do if you don't even believe in you. Why would you think or expect anybody else that's around you to? I done did things that I regret. I done said things I can't take back. Was a lost soul at a crossroad who had no hope, but I changed it. I spent years of my life holding on to things I never should have kept, full of hatred. Years of my life carrying a lot of baggage that I should have walked away from. Years of my life wishing I was someone different.
Outside
for
Adams
validation.
For a three in the win. That's going to bounce off tiptoe by Keith. That's the buzzer. Good! It's good! It's good! The Cardinals win it!
Evil, difficult to go through, yes, but beneficial. Some would say having a mental breakdown is a negative thing, which on one hand I agree, but on the other hand, it was the push I needed to get help and start the healing process. See if I didn't ever hit
my again. Yeah, anyways, we're back.
And those were some of the ghetto taco sights and sounds from this past week. And well, are you guys hungry? Because I kind of am.
I'm very hungry.
Yeah, I mean, I could go for a Crunchwrap from Ghetto Tacos right now. That's how every day and pick
my son up or a burrito and let
him know he's loved. Dude, the burritos are good. Questioning if those are limited time offers though, I think. Like maybe every couple weeks they're doing. Yeah, Thursday. Okay.
I've been noticing that he'll never be enough. 30 years of running, 30 years of
searching, 30 years of hurting, 30 years of pain. I'll have to go get something today. Sounds good. But welcome into the Sports Timeout Podcast, brought to you by Jack. 30 years of hopeless, and our newest sponsor, Roberts Integrative Dentistry in Joplin. Looking for a new dentist? Go check them out. Got my stuff done this last week. Got a filling and a cleaning all in a, 6-day span? So, yeah, good job by them. Appreciate it. Well done.
My buddy Blake and his wife, I believe.
Blake and Shelby.
Awesome. Roberts Dentistry.
It
go
is.
Go clean your teeth.
I'm Wes.
My buddies.
Tony.
Yeah, buddies. I guess.
Clint,
our buddies
for the show here too as well.
Yes.
Lots of buddies here. But on that note, you guys ready to start?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And first up, we'll talk XFL. And what were y'all's thoughts here? Now that the NFL is over, the XFL begins and their reboot, that is. Beautiful game for Sunday last week for St. Louis. And what are your all's thoughts on that one? And how the XFL's done so far. Tony, we'll start you.
I enjoyed it. I like the whenever they did the reboot 2 years ago before or 3 years ago before COVID. I thought they did very, very well. It was entertaining back then, and it kind of just picked up where it left off. It's just as entertaining, and I like that they were able to show off one of the new rules, being the 3-point conversion rule.
Yeah, I really liked it.
Yeah, they had to make a big play and they took advantage of it.
Indeed.
Clint? I think the XFL could actually be like legit this time too. I thought that the first time around, and then I guess it was just because of COVID that it stopped. But I think it could be like a one thing is just a. I do think people are like football hungry a lot, and so once this, and sometimes not even the Super Bowl, but sometimes if you're like a, I don't know, a Texans fan, kind of like halfway through the season, you're already ready for like another kind of football. And so I think they have, it's kind of it's a prime spot where it's like people that want to see football can keep watching. Yeah, there you go. Keep watching football. And you get to introduce all these new rules. Like Tony said, we got this 3-point thing. Oh man, my favorite thing, the Battlehawks just did this to win their win where instead of onside kicking it, you can convert a 4th and 15.
Yeah.
So cool. I'm not sure that one. I'm not sure if they would ever introduce in the NFL. It is pretty abstract, but if it keeps being successful and we have these awesome games, I could see the NFL being like, you know what? Onside kicks work 2% of the time and they're so boring. Maybe we should try this 4th and 15 thing and just see if it's.
And the Eagles win the Super Bowl on an onside kick.
Yeah. And on 3, I mean, cause theoretically it's almost like make it, take it. Cause yeah. you could just keep throwing 4th and 15s forever. Now, if you don't get it, it's their ball in the 25-yard line. But I thought that was really fun and like and attainable. But I feel like onside kicks are just so, you know, it's just kind of, it's like, oh, the ball is kind of dribbling. Did someone get it? Okay, they got it. You know, it's not exactly the NFL, whether good or bad, really want, they like the aesthetic of watching football. They like the idea that it's fun. That's why they like seeing more passing. They've really made it easy for the quarterback because they like the passing. And I think the XFL is definitely going to experiment with stuff like that of like, okay, that's really fun. And the thing we're doing in the NFL, though technically is traditional, is kind of boring. We could try this, and I think people would enjoy it.
Yeah.
The 3-point one probably being the biggest one. Like, I could actually see them, like, in 2 or 3 years introducing that in the NFL.
Very well.
Yeah. It would make games a little bit more interesting.
Yeah. In terms of just scheming out, like, if I'm down by 18, well, we could score 2 touchdowns and a 3-point conversion twice, and then we can tie the game.
Well, I think it'd be equivalent to like an underdog getting a knockout, like in the later rounds after losing the whole fight.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. So like, and it's happened where like a fighter dominates the whole time, and they have 1-2 good combos and changes the whole dynamic of the fight.
Yeah.
So,
I think what most sports want to get rid of is that thing, even though it's like kind of unfair to the good team, but they probably want to get rid of. When they're up, a team's up 42-7, and there's still a quarter and a half left. And it's like, why are we watching this? There's really literally no way this team's going to come back, and the people turn it off. Yeah. So they probably, even though it's not fair to the teams and might make results kind of like a more wary, they probably like the idea of like, well, technically, kind of like what the Battlehawks did in that first game where they were down by, I think, like 20 with a minute and a half left or something like that and came back. It's like that does make the game more intriguing, even if it's like, even if you're the winning team, it's like, oh, come on, we didn't even get the ball back because they just kept doing these freaking 4th and 15s and winning the game. But, you know, I think it's going to be for that alone. Because at first I didn't know how fun the XFL would be, but I think for that stuff alone, it's going to be fun.
And man, the tickets are cheaper than a Kansas City Sporting game.
Yeah.
Or current game. They're like $30.
Yep.
We should
We're all going this weekend. No, just kidding.
Yeah, like you get box seats for like $80. I'm making that up, but
it's like $200, but
it's pretty good actually. It's like the price of a normal cheap seat.
Next up we talk the original football for a couple of subjects here, and we'll start out in the NWSL. The US team, the She Believes Cup. Went on this past week, and the U.S. national women's team, they came out on top. And, Brazil, they had a good run there, too. But, what's really important here, though, is AD French for the current and playing goalkeeper for Team USA there. And then one of the newer additions in Debinha for Brazil on Wednesday was a very physical game between those two. Debinha played some great offense and defense. I'm excited for that. But yeah, the current and the two world-renowned players, probably more than that. I mean, Haley Mace is up in there and a few more on top of that. But yeah, women's soccer team, 4 straight. Something that's not really been talked about a lot, but 4 straight wins in the She Believes Cup. That's pretty impressive. And they've won 6 out of 8 tournaments that they've played. And that's all 8 tournaments, by the way. So just 8 all around. 6 of them the U.S. has won. England's won. And I don't remember who the other one was. But, yeah, that's pretty impressive. What are your all's thoughts here? I mean, is that a streak that should be more talked about and more hyped up? Or do you think it's eh?
Maybe so. I don't have a lot of opinions on the league specifically. So I'd be making stuff up if I didn't know what I was talking about. But I will say the Women's Soccer League is definitely the most, competitively fun, yeah, like, in terms of, like, you're getting the peak of that sport. Yeah. for what the women's sports offer. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like, a lot of times, like, whether fairly or not, probably fairly, it's usually like the lesser version of the men's thing we think of. It's like WNBA, NBA, blah, 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 blah. Women's soccer, it kind of feels like you're seeing, like, the real, you know, it's not any less version than a men's version of soccer. So I've always been intrigued by the fact, you know, our women's U.S. team is so good. We're literally getting the best of the best in terms of skill and technique. So yeah, that part intrigues me. Mahomes owns our state team, so it makes me even more intrigued. But I don't know anything about NWSL, so that's about where it ends.
His wife is an investor as well, so the Mahomes family owns.
Oh, that's true. That's true. I got to give her credit for that.
And to add to your point, Clint, I think you hit the nail on the head perfectly. What I was going to say, the women's, whenever they're playing, they're a lot more aggressive versus their male counterparts who are flopping and you know, acting the whole time. And I'm not saying that to dog anybody. I mean, that's a technique. So, like, I understand that. I mean, as much as we hate it, that is a skill to have in the in the soccer world. But I like seeing the opposite version of that is whenever they're being very aggressive. Yeah. So
incredible.
I think there's a lot of aggressiveness in women's soccer, a lot more than in the men's.
Yeah. Next up, we'll talk MLS and Coach Peter Vermees for Sporting Kansas City getting a 5-year extension on Wednesday. This is a guy who loves to win, hates to lose. You love that in a coach. A man who coached an injured team out of last place and almost into the playoffs last year. If Agata and Tommy didn't have the visa issues going on, last season's results could have been a little bit different, with Sporting just edging their way back into a postseason. But just after the arrival of those two, Sporting instantly got better and went on a 7-game winning streak. And that was incredible. I mean, that was a great GM move by Peter Vermees. That was a great coaching we got to see, Tony, when we went up there. I mean, we got to see that streak pretty much until, what, the end of October when the season ended? And that last game was a heartbreaker they lost. But wasn't that awesome? And are you excited for Coach?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that Coach Vermees is very, very deserving. And
there was a silver lining.
Yeah, I mean, he didn't want to see it in the beginning whenever I first asked him. If I were to talk to him again, I'd ask him how it feels to be wrong. I think that fire, even though that it was a loss, you know, I think it built a fire in them, and not only in the locker room, but in the manager room, to get, you know, some people that were going to be game changers. And I think they did a very good job with Tommy and Agata last year. I'm excited to see him this year.
We're going to get in on that post game wine this year, see how we can get hooked up with that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. every day and every game, they get Coach Vermees gets a cup of wine from one of the fans.
Hides it behind his power water there too. I don't know if I'm allowed to have this out, but hey, good for you, Coach. That you do you. We love it. We really do.
He's an adult.
Yeah, it's very true. Clint, anything on Sporting?
Just, you know, as long as he's older than 21, then he can drink that wine.
Are you going to join us in any of the games? Or join Wes, technically?
Wait, say it again?
Are you going to join Wes and I at any of the games?
I think I should. I'm really intrigued by the...
Have you ever been?
What? I've never been. Yeah, yeah. I don't...
It's awesome.
That might be a fun venture, actually, for this year, is like Clint gets into MLS soccer. Yeah, I haven't tried it all, and I think it would be fun. And also, yeah. they called did they call, is the correct nomenclature calling them sporting? That sounds funny.
The yeah. Sports.
Like sporting scores, sporting, is that what it is?
Yeah, you know,
sporting,
like.
Yeah, sporting KC.
You know, when people like, you go sport, you know, that's them.
Literally, yeah. You go sporting. Okay, yeah. But yeah, I'd love to go it again.
Hey, as long as you bring Florpy with you.
Yeah, absolutely. A character I do for the listeners who probably don't care.
And send me a link after this.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll link in the comments for Florpy.
we now switch to the NBA, and we'll talk a trending topic that hit this week, and that is performance from players, therefore lack of, actually. I mean, what got me is players like Lonzo Ball, LeBron, Westbrook, and so on. These guys get a lot of rest. And granted, two of the guys that I mentioned are older, but the NBA commissioner, Adam Silver, came out with his concerns at the All-Star break, talking about load management and how it's now affecting the players, basically saying players, if healthy, should play. And if they're not healthy, don't force them to play. Just go ahead and have them sit out those games until they are ready to play. But there's also going to be some extra testing going on just to make sure that everything's going good and that they're not sitting for no reason and stuff like that, because that's kind of the abuse of the player management situation and so on. But I mean, long resting, a lot of healthy players get hurt actually when you do that. And in fact, the Bulls' DeMar DeRozan was quoted saying something that I thought was pretty impressive. Like, hey, if you're going to sit out these games, you have to play at least 78 of them as a minimum to be considered in the MVP vote. If not, then just go ahead and play the game and basically kind of stop wimping out and doing laziness, basically. Oh, my calf hurts, or, oh, I need to sit tonight, my girlfriend's coming, or something like that. I don't know. But, I mean, what are your all's thoughts here? Should that be better taken care of? Clint, we'll go you first.
Yeah, so this is a big thing for me, because theoretically, the NBA is my favorite sport. Basketball is my favorite sport. So yeah. Theoretically, the NBA should be my favorite league. But the past 3 years, I think the product has just not been good.
Yeah.
And I think it is because of that. I think, you know, you get away with a lot of games in baseball because you're up there for 10 seconds, you hit a ball, you move on, you try to, you know, there's not a lot. In basketball, it became very clear. In fact, someone made this point that, you know, it really became this mantra with NBA, and it really became this, you're only cool if you win a championship. It's all about getting that ring. It's all about winning the championship, right? And so now, why wouldn't players be like, well, in that case, what does it matter if we're the 2 seed or the 3 seed and I play every game? It's like, as long as I'm healthy and we win a championship, that's all people are going to remember. And it's made the product, I mean, the All-Star game was like the epitome of this, right? Where it's just like, yeah. I mean, granted, that the All-Star game has never been like amazing. It's always just like
people USA are versus the world.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the better way to do it. Because it's never, or even in baseball where I'm not sure if they still do this, where the winner gets home field advantage or whatever. But either way, it's never really been a great product because you can't try full anyways. But now it's just too much to, I think there's too much money involved, too many people who go to games with their kids or whatever, excited about it, to like, well, because I'm trying to think of a player, because Luka just played last night in a back-to-back, he's not going to play tonight. They're like, oh, you bought a ticket with your son who's a big Luka fan, but now he's not going to play because we're just resting him up so we win the championship. And it just makes it makes the feeling of the season feel like, let's just get to the end of the season. And I'm a big NBA fan. I listen to podcasts that are NBA fans, and they feel the same way, where it's like, even in their heads, it's kind of like, this is fun, and I think this is the MVP, and this player, ooh, he's fun, and here comes a rookie. But in general, let's just get to the playoffs. And yeah. that's never really a fun place to be. Whereas compared to the NFL, it feels like every week matters, every game matters, every play matters. The NBA, it's just, even in a big, supposed big Sunday, you know, Sunday afternoon game with the Warriors and the Suns, whoever it is, it still kind of feels like, oh, but Clay's not playing because he played last week. And even if there are injuries, there's injuries. I'd much rather a player play all 82 games and play 5 less years in his whole career than do this thing where we just have a boring season. But technically, the guy plays for 25 years. I just feel like I'd rather have a better product. So that's my big rant.
Agree, Tony, or disagree?
Yeah, no, I think he makes a really good point. But to add to that, I think the team should be able to, from here on out, be able to restructure contracts to, you know, for them playing like half the minutes in the game, like in a game, or being an active player in half the games, because, like, you know, to add on to Clint's rant, people go out there to watch LeBron or to go watch Curry or Clay or whoever, and if they're not playing, you know, that's people's hard-earned money that they want to go watch, you know, the top players. Like, I would be upset if I went to a Chiefs game and Mahomes wasn't playing. Yep. Like, as much as I hate to say it, but that's part of the entertainment. I want to watch it.
Yeah.
You know, so, and just because he played, you know, a hard game, you know, a few days before.
Yeah.
So that's just me adding on to what Clint said. But I think they should be able to, but my point is, I think the teams from here on out should be able to restructure deals around activity as well.
Yeah. For the coaches and everybody, almost, because it's probably coaches and even GM's decisions of like, well, we want to win a championship, so Giannis, you know, or Luka, take a break. It's kind of an overall team thing where it's like, you can't do that. You know,
yeah.
you have to keep playing and you know, pretend like every game matters.
I think they should find management.
Or just make less games, which that's a tougher ask for the NBA because now you're getting less money. But theoretically, if there were 72 games, everybody would win, but we'll see.
Yeah. Next up, we're going to go ahead and finish out with NCAA Division II and the MIAA tournament coming up. MSSU looking to make an impression on both sides here. For the men, they have Northwest Missouri State left this weekend. And after a very interesting game last night, MSSU needs to win out to stay competitive. This way they can stay in the sixth seed spot. Coach McMahon has led this team to a heck of a first season for him, coming in with all the adversity of Coach Boshi leaving. Phenomenal job. And is only losing two players after this season. So for them, this is just a year of let's go for it. So really nothing to lose, all to gain. Proud of them. Pittman, they're out of it. Women are ranked number 6 in the region. Yeah. And behind them, for Missouri Southern, that is, are ranked number 6 in the nation, or region, sorry. And behind them, the 8th seed in the central region for women's side, loaded with teams from the MIAA. And that would be Pitt State there. Their regular season MIAA champs, Nebraska Kearney, they're the number 1 team in that. Number 2, Central Missouri, is ranked 3rd. And then MSSU is ranked number 5 there in the MIAA and 6th in the region. Number 3, Missouri Western, is in the 7th place spot in the MIAA, in the region, and 4th in the MIAA. And then Pitt State is ranked number 8 and 6th in the MIAA. Fort Hays State is ranked number 10. So, yeah, 6 teams in the MIAA are currently ranked in the central region. 6 teams in the MIAA are ranked in the region. This conference is incredible. That's why I say it twice. I mean, MSSU and Pitt, they can meet up again, but wow, like, how awesome is it for MSSU D2 to have that many in that D2 category? I mean, just that region right there is a powerhouse.
Yep. Yep. They could probably beat every other region.
Yeah.
Pretty easy from there.
I mean, each team could be in its own region, and then they meet up in, what, the Elite Eight or something like that. But
yeah,
it would be phenomenal to watch. And I hope that they have a good rest of the season. I hope they win out this weekend, and I hope that they make it far in the MIAA tournament coming up next weekend. Hopefully we'll be there for one of those games, but if not, we will be watching from home and cheering them on. All MSSU alum here, and yeah, on that note, we will go ahead and head to the local sports update, brought to you by Trackside Burgers. They are open at 1515 West 10th Street in Joplin, so catch them in Joplin for your tailgate and catering needs. And well, boys and girls seasons are over for basketball in high school. It's crazy to say that season went quick, but districts start on Wednesday at Ozark, and Joplin will play Central at 5:30. Joplin ranked number 4. Carthage will play Kickapoo at 7. They are the 7 seed, and Neosho will take on Republic at 8:30. And yeah, Neosho the 6 seed there. And then Class 5, District 7, number 2 Webb City will take on number 7 Carl Junction. That should be a fun game. It was a couple nights ago. And for the girls bracket, Class 6 on the 6th, 6th seed there. Yeah, you have number 8. Sorry, not number 6 seed, but you have number 8 Joplin versus the number 1 Republic. And that begins at 4 p.m. 7 seed Neosho takes on number 2 Nixa at 7 p.m. and Carthage at Kickapoo at 8:30. And then in Class 5, number 1 CJ plays against Ruskin, and number 2 Webb plays against number 7 Benton at 5 p.m. So, Tony, you got the wrestling stuff. What's up with that?
So Webb City had one qualifier for the state tournament. And his name is Colt Taylor. He got second place. I believe it was weight class 138, 132. He's smaller weight class, but he wrestled pretty good all season. He probably one of the more consistent wrestlers on the team, and you know, was getting win after win after win, and he ended up getting second. So congratulations,
awesome,
on behalf of us. So I think he starts wrestling today. Hopefully has a successful weekend, and hopefully brings home some hardware.
Draven Van Gilder for Joplin. He came on the show earlier. Glad to see that his football career ended well, and so will his wrestling career as he is at state. And then 9 from Carl Junction, pretty much the whole team down in Neosho.
Yep.
And on that note, we will finish out with a 2-minute warning brought to you by Hot Stone Pizzeria. Go grab one of the specials this weekend. I may have to go get the Gracie Dunder Duder with red sauce, salami, beef, mini pepperoni, and onions. Sounds good. And MSSU women and men will head to Northwest Missouri State to finish out their season. Tip is at 1:30 p.m. there with men to follow. And then Pitt, the Gorillas, will end their season on the road at Missouri Western. Women are set to tip at 1:30 as well, with the men to follow. For baseball, 9-4 MSSU will head to 8-4 Pitt State today for a 3 o'clock game on the road. And, that will be their first pitch at 3 p.m., obviously. And then tomorrow at 2 and Sunday at 12. As for softball, MSSU will host the MIAA GLVC crossover today. They will host Missouri S&T at 4 p.m. And that will be tomorrow. And then at 12 p.m. they will host Rockhurst as well at 12:30 for that one, excuse me. And then at 5:30 they will take on Southwest Baptist University. And Sunday they will take on Truman State in a doubleheader starting at 3 p.m. with game 2 to follow. Pitt State softball, they will head to Washburn Invite today. They will take on Southwest Minnesota State at 3:30 p.m. Tomorrow they will take on Missouri St. Louis at 1:30 p.m. and St. Cloud State at 5:30 p.m. And then on Sunday they wrap up at 9:30 a.m. with Minnesota Crookston. Of course, all these games and events are pending to the weather and the current and fluid COVID-19 situation, so stay tuned to each team's social media pages for times and updates. And music is here. So that's the end of another episode for Tony, Clint, and myself. Have a great and safe weekend. Make sure you all go get some tacos from Ghetto Tacos Food Truck or Shop. Next Tuesday, buy 5, get 1 free. Buy 10, get 3 free. If you don't want that, go Wednesday for 10% off your nachos. Also, Thursday, can't forget to spend $10 and get a free soft drink. So which one are you all getting before we run out here?
Yes.
I guess the Thursday burrito. Sounds good. Yeah, and yes.